The complete works of Swami Vivekananda. One existence appearing as many. Lecture delivered by Swamiji in New York in 1896. Part 1. Vairagya or renunciation is the turning point in all the various yogas. The karmi worker renounces the fruits of his work. The bhakta devotee renounces all little loves for the Almighty and the Omnipresent Love. The yogi renounces his experiences because his philosophy is that the whole nature, although it is for the experience of the soul, at last brings him to know that he is not in nature but eternally separate from nature. The jnani philosopher renounces everything because his philosophy is that nature never existed, neither in the past, nor in the present, nor will it in the future. The question of utility cannot be asked in these higher themes. It is very absurd to ask it. And even if it is to be asked, after a proper analysis, what do we find in this question of utility? The ideal of happiness, that which brings man more happiness, is of greater utility to him than these higher things which do not improve his material conditions or bring him such great happiness. All the sciences are for this one end, to bring happiness to humanity, and that which brings the larger amount of happiness, man takes and gives up that which brings a lesser amount of happiness. We have seen how happiness is either in the mind or in the body, or in the Atman. With animals and in the lowest human beings, who are very much like animals, happiness is all in the body. No man can eat with the same pleasure as a famished dog or a wolf. So in the dog and the wolf, the happiness is entirely in the body. In men we find a higher plane of happiness, that of thought. And in the jnani, there is the highest plane of happiness in the self, the Atman. So to the philosopher, this knowledge of the self is of the highest utility, because it gives him the highest happiness possible. Sense gratifications or physical things cannot be of the highest utility to him, because he does not find in them the same pleasure that he finds in knowledge itself. And after all, knowledge is the one goal and is really the highest happiness that we all know. All who work in ignorance are, as it were, the draught animals of the devas. The word deva is used here in the sense of a wise man. All the people that work and toil and labor like machines do not really enjoy life, but it is a wise man who enjoys. A rich man buys a picture at a cost of $100,000 perhaps, but it is a man who enjoys and understands art really enjoys it. And if the rich man is without knowledge of art, it is useless to him. He is only the owner. All over the world, it is the wise man who enjoys the happiness of the world. The ignorant man never enjoys. He has to work for others unconsciously. Thus far, we have seen the theories of the Advaitist philosophers. How there is but one Atman. There cannot be two. We have seen how in the whole of this universe, there is but one existence, and that one existence, when seen through the senses, is called the world of matter. When it is seen through the mind, it is called the world of thoughts and ideas. And when it is seen as it is, then it is the one infinite being. You must bear this in mind it is not that there is a soul in man, although I had to take that for granted in order to explain it at first, but that there is only one existence, and that one, the Atman, the Self. And when this is perceived through the senses, through sense imageries, it is called the body. When it is perceived through thought, it is called the mind. When it is perceived in its own nature, it is the Atman, the only one existence. So it is not that there are three things in one, the body and the mind and the Self, although that was a very convenient way of putting it in the course of explanation. But all is that Atman, and that one being is sometimes called the body, sometimes the mind, and sometimes the Self, according to different vision. There is but one being which the ignorant call the world. When a man goes higher in the knowledge, he calls the very same being the world of thought. Again, when knowledge itself comes, all illusions vanish, and man finds it is all nothing but Atman. I am that one existence. This is the last conclusion. There are neither three nor two in the universe. It is all one. That one, under the illusion of Maya, is seen as many, just as a rope is seen as a snake. It is the very rope that is seen as the snake. There are not two things there, a rope separate and a snake separate. No man sees these two things there at the same time. Dualism and non-dualism are very good philosophic terms, but in perfect perception we never perceive the real and the false at the same time. We are all born monoists. We cannot help it. We always perceive the one. When we perceive the rope, we do not perceive the snake at all. And when we see the snake, we do not see the rope at all. It has vanished. When you see illusion, you do not see reality. Suppose you see one of your friends coming at a distance in the street. You know him very well, but through the haze and the mist that is before you, you think that it is another man. When you see your friend as another man, you do not see your friend at all. He has vanished. You are perceiving only one. Suppose your friend is Mr. A. But when you perceive Mr. B, A as Mr. B, you do not see Mr. A at all. In each case, you perceive only one. When you see yourself as a body, you are body and nothing else. And that is the perception of the vast majority of mankind. They may talk of soul and mind and all these things, but what they perceive is the physical form, the touch, taste, vision, and so on. Again, with certain men in certain state of consciousness, they perceive themselves as thought. You know, of course, the story of the Sir Humphrey Davy, who was making experiments before his class with laughing gas. And suddenly one of the tubes broke and the gas escaping, he breathed in it. For some moments he remained like a statue. Afterwards, he told his class that when he was in that state, he actually perceived that the whole world is made up of ideas. The gas for a time made him forget the consciousness of his body. And that very thing which he was seeing as the body, he began to perceive as ideas. When consciousness rises still higher, when this little funny consciousness is gone forever, that which is the reality behind shines. And we see it as the one existence, knowledge, bliss, the one Atman, the universal, one that is only knowledge itself, one that is bliss itself, one beyond all compare, beyond all limit, ever free, never bound, infinite as the sky, unchangeable as the sky. Such a one will manifest himself in your heart and in meditation.